Revelation. And we're in the book of Revelation. We're going through the seven seals. Last week, we kind of laid this out. There's going to be a series of judgments that are going to come as the world as we know it comes to an end. That day is going to come. We don't just study this because it somehow gives us some interesting information that we don't know. The Word of God in all areas is transformational for our life. And so the Word that we study today, while sometimes it may be a little bit difficult, we're here to read it, to seek to understand it, and then to go out and live it, because you'll see application for this in your life today. And so last week, we did those first four seals. And the first four seals were four horsemen. The four horsemen that brought judgment, that will bring judgment to the earth. These things are all happening in the future. It seems devastating. The reason it seems devastating is it will be devastating. Judgment is judgment. And today, what we're going to do is there's a window that's going to be opened up into the martyrs. There have been martyrs since the beginning of the church, way back in the book of Acts. People who died for the cause of Christ. There are more people being martyred today than any time in history. Because when you receive Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior and proclaim that in many areas of the world today, it's almost an instant death sentence. And so, folks, we are privileged to live in freedom. We are privileged to gather like this. We are privileged to have as many people as we want to come and worship together. We don't have to put guards at the door because we're worried about the government coming in and shutting us down. This is not the privilege that much of the world knows today, especially as people are worshiping the Lord and following Christ. So we're going to be looking at persecution today. Persecution is going to grow as time goes on, and we get a window into the future when we look in Revelation and we see martyrs literally in heaven crying out to the Lord. So persecution, past, present, and future, as we look at what Jesus spoke of in Matthew 24. Now last week we brought out that Matthew 24 is a place where Jesus is speaking to his disciples about that which is to happen in the end times. Jesus' words to his disciples, this is going to happen. Now, John ultimately gets taken into heaven, and this book of Revelation, a lot of it is a vision that John sees given to him by Jesus as to what is going to happen in the future. It all fits together. What Jesus said in Matthew 24, what Jesus is again saying in the book of Revelation. But listen to what Jesus says in Matthew 24:9 about persecution. It says this, then they will hand you over to be persecuted, and they will kill you. You will be hated by all nations because of my name. Does that sound like persecution, folks? Of course it does. And who's going to be doing the persecuting? We're going to see persecution from all nations against the Christians. By all nations against the Christians. Now, persecution will have a great effect on the church. If we go a couple verses further in this same chapter of Scripture in Matthew, here's what Jesus says. Then many will fall away, betray one another, and hate one another. Many false prophets will rise up and deceive many. Because lawlessness will multiply, the love of many will grow cold. This is a prophecy, folks, of something to come. I believe we have glimpses already of this prophecy. What's going to happen, and what we've seen a little bit happen, is that as persecution, as clamps get put on the church, there'll be many who will say, hey, I didn't sign up for this. You know, it was nice to go to church occasionally. You know, they sing some nice songs there, serve good cookies afterwards. It was nice to go to, but I've got to stand up for this, what I believe here. No, I'm not in for that. Jesus predicts mistakes that will happen. Many people will fall away. There'll be a natural sifting that happens in the church. A sifting between the people who really want to follow Jesus and those who are here just because, it's a personal obligation to come once in a while. Folks, when you become a Christian in most areas of the world where there's persecution now, you don't make a casual commitment to Christ. You're laying your life down. You're truly living out the words of Scripture. But you're going to deny yourself, and you're going to take up your cross, and you're going to follow the Lord. It's not a time where you can just put on Christ when you walk into a building like this and then go out there and live any way you want. It's a commitment. You know, it's interesting because we had COVID a few years ago, and when I read this line in Matthew 24, verse 12, it says, "The love of many will grow cold." There's going to be dissensions that are going to happen, even amongst the church. You know, during COVID, it was one of the strangest times. I talked to a good friend of mine, been a pastor for many years. He says, "In all my years of being pastoring, I've never seen such controversy as we had as we did in COVID. I never saw such dissension in the church as when we had COVID. The love of many grew cold." There were people who left churches because the church required you to wear masks. There were people who left churches because the church didn't require you to wear masks. There was a lot of dissension that went on within the church over COVID. I think looking back, there was a lot of testing that was going on for the church during that time. There were some states where even declarations went out from the government that if you see people meeting together in your neighborhood, if you see a variety of cars come in front of one person's house because they might be having something like a Bible study, by all means, report them to the police so that they can be picked up. We know in Canada, north of us, that there was much greater persecution that went on in the church at that time. We got just a little bit of a test during that time. I would submit this now that we can look back. The churches that stood up, the churches that kept meeting, the churches that said, no, we are going to obey God above all else. I believe those churches thrived and grew. I think churches that caved and said, no, we're going to do whatever we're told. It's a big test. Folks, there's going to be more of that. We've got to resolve what sort of resolve we're going to have in moving forward as a church. But Jesus predicts love is going to grow cold. You know, in Jesus, he gave us stories called parables. And so I want you to listen to this parable that he tells in Matthew 13. It's not on the screen, but listen to this parable because this sets up what we're going to talk about today. And the parable isn't one of those real familiar ones like the parable of the prodigal son. This is a parable of the wheat and the weeds. And so there is going to be some persecution. And listen to see if you can hear it in here. So Matthew 13, verse 24. He presented another parable to them. He said, "The kingdom of heaven may be compared to a man who sowed good seed in his field. But while people were sleeping, his enemy came, sowed weeds among the wheat, and left. When the plants sprouted and produced grain, then the weeds also appeared. The landowner's servants came to him and said, 'Master, didn't you sow good seed in your field? Then where did the weeds come from?' 'An enemy did this,' he told them. 'So do you want us to go out and pull them up?' the servants asked him. 'No,' he said. 'When you pull up the weeds, you might also uproot the wheat with them. Let both grow together until the harvest. At harvest time, I'll tell the reapers, gather the weeds first and tie them in bundles to burn them, but collect the wheat in my barn.'" Now, there's the parable. It really presents some very important things for us. Wheat and weeds. We ask this oftentimes in our own gardens. Who planted the weeds? The weeds are planted there by the enemy. That's the purpose of the parable. Well, who are the weak amongst us? I'm sure the disciples, when they heard this, and as well as other people, what does this mean? Well, a few verses later, in verse 36, Jesus takes time to explain it. Listen to his explanation. Then he left the crowds and went into the house. His disciples approached him and said, "Explain to us the parable of the weeds in the field." He replied, "The one who sows the good seed is the Son of Man. The field is the world, and the good seed, these are the children of the kingdom. The weeds are the children of the evil one, and the enemy who sowed them is the devil. The harvest is the end of the age, and the harvesters are angels. Therefore, just as the weeds are gathered and burned in the fire, so it will be at the end of the age. The Son of Man will send out his angels, and they will gather from his kingdom all who cause sin and those guilty of lawlessness. They will throw them into the blazing furnace, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Then the righteous will shine like the sun in the Father's kingdom. Let anyone who has ears listen." Wow, what a powerful parable. This is very real. What's Jesus saying here? He's saying the church, the true church, the church, this good seed, this wheat, is growing amongst weeds. Does that make sense, church? Yes, it's growing amongst weeds. And sometimes, please listen, sometimes weeds even grow up within the church. But here's what we've got for the church, and the favor of God rests upon us in that we're living in a time of grace. So with God's power, the power of salvation, the power of regeneration, weeds can actually be turned into wheat. And so that's why we proclaim the Word of God. We proclaim it right here in this church. We proclaim it right here in this town, because there's weeds in this town. We proclaim it in this country. We go to places like Japan, because weeds can turn into wheat with the power of God. That's why we proclaim the gospel. There's going to be a harvest one day. A harvest. And the harvest is going to bring all the wheat, the Christians, and we're going to be brought to the Lord Himself. And then we're going to enjoy all eternity with Him forever. And those who aren't part of that harvest, they'll be judged. And they'll go to hell. That's why we preach the good news of Jesus, to call people out of darkness into the light. Now let's go to our text today, Revelation chapter 6, verse 9. When He opened the fifth seal, who's opening the seals? Jesus. "I saw under the altar the souls of those who had been slaughtered because of the word of God and the testimony they had given." So we need to use our imaginations when we read scriptures like this. John is having a vision. John, of course, when he's seeing this for the first time, he's thinking, wow, he recognizes an altar. Okay. He has some context for recognizing the altar. He's hung around the temple. He knows what an altar looks like. So he recognizes an altar. And then he recognizes the souls of those who are martyred. They're martyred, and they're under the altar. Now you say, well, how does he know all that? Well, I don't know exactly who's standing with them. I'm sure there's maybe an angel or two standing with them. I'm sure, just like we who would experience something for the first time, we might ask a profound question like this: what's that? And he gets an answer, and then he writes it down. So there's these souls. I don't know what souls look like. I don't know if it's if they're real bodies there or not. But he recognizes this, and the point is, these people are martyrs. Now, let's ask the first question. What kind of an altar is this? Now, we've spoken here because we went through the whole tabernacle about a year ago. And we know that when we think about the tabernacle, we learn about a couple of different altars in the tabernacle. So when you walked into that tabernacle courtyard, the first big altar is one where they sacrificed animals on it, okay? It's a much bigger altar, and they brought animals there to sacrifice. That's one altar. We can have that in our mind. Well, then as we proceeded in the tabernacle, we actually went to this first place that was tented in, okay? And it was called the Holy Place. Now, within the Holy Place, there were a few different things that God wanted there, one of which was called an altar of incense. An altar of incense. The altar of incense didn't sacrifice animals on it, but there were spices that were burnt in this altar of incense, special spices for only that altar, and it centered all around the prayers of God's people. So two altars, one that sacrificed animals, it involved blood, okay, another that was burning incense in there for prayers for God's people. We read in Exodus 40, verse 5, place the gold altar for incense in front of the Ark of the Testimony, put on the screen for the entrance to the tabernacle. So what would happen with that one, that altar of incense, is every morning the high priest would burn incense. But once a year, there would be blood sprinkled on the four horns of that altar. It was on the Day of Atonement. The Day of Atonement is all about atoning for people's sins. Huh. Well, this altar that John is seeing in Revelation, is it one of these altars? I don't think so. I don't think it's one of those altars, but I think those altars will speak to what kind of altar this is. See, whose blood was essentially on the altar that John was seeing now in heaven? It was the blood of the martyrs. The martyrs. They had literally given their lives. They had paid the ultimate sacrifice for the Lord Jesus Christ. Their blood was shed for the cause of Christ. And this altar somehow is all about prayer. And that comes up again in the book of Revelation. What kind of prayer? What kind of prayer? Intercessory prayer. God's people, our people, right here, are to be a part of intercessory prayer, praying on behalf of others. So, why are they under the altar? That's a logical question. Well, the clue that I give you here is sin. Well, the question is, whose sin? Well, Leviticus 4:7 says, place the gold altar for incense in front of the Ark of the Testimony. Put up the screen. I think I have the wrong verse there. You on the right verse? There you do. You have it right up there. Let's read that verse together. The priest is to apply some of the blood to the horns of the altar of fragrant incense that is before the Lord in the tent of meeting. He must pour out the rest of the bull's blood at the base of the altar, the burnt offering that is at the entrance of the tent of meeting. So we have this big altar there. There's blood that goes on the horns, and then there's blood that also goes underneath. The blood of the altar of the burnt offerings was for the sin of the people. What had these martyrs done? They died upholding the word of God. They essentially died because of the sin of other people who killed them. The blood under the altar we see here was sacrificed to the heart of God. So just as there are people being martyred today because they love God above all else, their lives are being taken because they love God above government. They love God above any other gods. These are those that are under this altar in heaven. And so when we think about that, when we think about that their blood was shed, when we look at their prayer, and we look at their prayer that they're calling on the Lord to avenge for their blood, think of what would go into that. that the Lord is going to bring judgment on people for killing these children for believing him above all else. And so the next question that can be asked is, why have these martyrs been slain? Well, the answer is clearly given. The first reason is because of the word of God. You know, folks, as long as I'm here, as long as the Lord gives me breath, I'm going to ask you to bring your Bible to church. We've got about 5% of you that bring your Bible to church. One of the reasons I want you to bring your Bible to church is because you even have the privilege of carrying this Bible around. Another reason I want you to bring this Bible to church is there's a chance to open your Bible. There's a chance to write in your Bible. There's a chance to take notes in your Bible. Because, folks, this is the sword of the Spirit, and this is what we need to be strong in this world. These people are killed because of the Word of God. Because of the Word of God, these people call out other people, and they call out to other people to repent of their sins. They will tell people, according to the Bible, that they can be made right with God. They will be people who will not look for a political solution to the problems of the world. They will be people who will continue to say, the answer is here, and it's not over there in Washington, D.C., Des Moines, or wherever. Folks, when we look at the condition of our world, I mean, really, just pause for a second. This past week, we have a president who can barely walk across a room and put three sentences together into a coherent paragraph. And we have somebody running for president that's in court right now, and whether you agree with the court case or not, he's in court because of multiple affairs he's had with women who aren't his wife. And we think the solution is going to come in November to our problems in America? Really? We think that there's even a possibility of a political solution to the problems in our country? Really? We think that? Folks, it's not going to happen. It's never going to happen. It's not going to happen in 2024. It's not going to happen in 2028. It's not going to happen in 2032. The solution is not a political one. The solution is a spiritual one. And folks in the church, I just want to admonish you in this. Don't think that it's there. Put all the bumper stickers you want. Put all the signs in your front yard you want. The solution isn't there. It's here. You have to believe in faith. It's here. It's right here in the Scripture, and it's going to come through the church. See, we've got to believe that with everything we've got, because if we don't believe that with everything we've got, we're going to somehow rest on Washington. It's not going to happen. It's just not going to happen. It was never designed that way. Washington will rise and Washington will fall, just like Rome rose and it fell. And every other place that thought it was a great empire rose and fell. The solution is in the Scriptures. These very martyrs lost their lives because they believed it here. And the more we believe it here, the more people will rise up and say, you are crazy. And we're not crazy, folks. The solution has always been in the Word of God. And so when it comes to the Word of God, we're going to believe it, we're going to witness to it, we're going to live by it, we're going to study it, we're going to preach it, we're going to pray over it, we're going to memorize it, we're going to meditate on it, we're going to apply it. That's what we're going to do with the Word of God. And the world is going to react against the Word of God, and they will, as they're doing today in other nations, they'll kill believers because of it. Why? Why? Because the more we're into the Word of God, Christians will say, my loyalty is first and foremost to Jesus Christ, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And I'm not going to waver in that. My loyalty is to Jesus. The more we read that, and the less we read it, the more we're able to say, well, you know, I pledge allegiance to the flag. Got nothing against the flag. But our loyalty must be to Jesus above all else. Above all else, it must be to Jesus. And we need Christians who are willing to rise up and show that loyalty against many antichrists that are going to appear in this world. The more godless our country becomes, and dear people, I'm a happy guy. I'm an encouraging guy. But do you believe with me that our country is becoming more and more godless? Yes. Now, here's the trajectory that we're on. the more godless we become, the more God is flushed out of our nation. Something or someone has to replace that. Godlessness will be replaced by, listen, the state. I can guarantee it. Why? That's the way it's happened in history over and over. Godlessness will be replaced by the state. Our allegiance will have to be to the state. The state will take over everything. Do we see that happening? The state wants to have our kids. The state wants to have as much money that they can have. The state wants us to be dependent on them for everything. The state, the state, the state, the state. God, 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 God. This is the trajectory that we're on. We've got to see it because it's happening before our very eyes. And whenever the state completely takes over, it never, emphasis on the word, never works. It hasn't worked throughout history. Where the state has completely taken over now, it's not working now. People will be oppressed. Satan and his demons are rejoicing when the state takes over. The only solution to the world's problem is the church, because we need a spiritual solution. Because the Bible demands loyalty of a person, loyalty to live a righteous life, loyalty to pursue Christ above all else, loyalty to pursue what's in this word, things that sometimes stand radically against what people want to believe today. What's going to happen is there's going to be people out there that are going to continue to ignore God. They're going to curse God. They're going to push away from God, reject God, disobey God. Sometimes those people are even within the church, okay? And most of the time, they're outside of the church, ridiculing the church. The martyrs that we see in this vision in the book of Revelation are people that were martyred because of the word of God. The second reason that they're there is because of their testimony. They spoke up about it. They'll believe that Jesus is the Son of God. They'll believe that Jesus is the Savior of the world. The world wants to reject Jesus. The world wants to reject his deity. The world rejects that he is Savior. These people died because they had the audacity to proclaim Jesus is Lord. Remember, folks, the oldest confession we have isn't the Apostles' Creed. The oldest creed we have is Jesus is Lord. Because when those New Testament Christians declared those three words, what they were saying is this: Caesar is not. Caesar's not. Many people lost their lives because they said, Jesus is Lord. And they are the martyrs described here. Let's go to verse 10. They cried out with a loud voice, Lord, the one who is holy and true, how long until you judge those who live on the earth and avenge our blood? You know, when you read through this entire seal, which is only three verses here in Revelation, one could ask the question, what's the judgment? I thought there was judgment coming out in each of these seals. Well, this one's just a little bit different. Some might say, well, is the judgment upon these people who are martyrs? No. The judgment comes upon the ungodly, not the godly. But what we see here is we get this window open to see these martyrs under the altar, and what they're doing is they're praying. And they're praying, oh Lord, how long is it going to be until you avenge for our blood? And then what we're going to see in seals 6 and 7, we're going to see judgment come forth in a most profound way. So this seal, the force behind this seal is prayer. And now people will ask this question, they'll be troubled by this. Praying for vengeance. I mean, really, folks, when you pray, do you pray for vengeance? It just doesn't sound Christian to pray for vengeance. Matter of fact, you can go back and look in the Psalms. Now I'm going to give a big word. You're probably the biggest word of the day, okay? You could use this in Scrabble sometime. You'll look really smart. Might be too many letters for Scrabble. The word is imprecatory. And say it. Imprecatory. Maybe a word you've never heard before. Imprecatory. there are psalms that are called imprecatory psalms. And what they do is they're actually calling down the vengeance of God on the enemies of God. So the psalmist is praying, Lord, wipe out your enemies. And you think, is that how we pray? I thought Jesus said, love your enemies. He did. And what about Stephen? Remember Stephen, that first martyr recorded in Scripture? Stephen, when he was being actually stoned because of his faith, one of the things he did is he actually said, Father, forgive them. Use the words of Jesus, for they don't know what they're doing. But now these martyrs that we see in Revelation, they're crying out to God, when are you going to avenge for our blood? Well, how do we process this? Well, I will say this. I prayed this. Many of you have prayed this prayer. Come, Lord Jesus, come. These are words that are at the end of Revelation that John prays. Come, Lord Jesus. I think the word quickly is actually used there. See, when we pray, come, Lord Jesus, come, which is something that I pray all the time. I think, Lord, come back, come back. What I'm praying is an imprecatory psalm there. Because, see, when I'm praying that the Lord, would you come back, that means I'm praying, Lord, would you come back, and you are going to judge your enemies. And this is what these martyrs were praying for, too. They were praying, Lord, would you come back and judge your enemies? Lord, would you come back and deal with Satan and all his demons? Lord, would you come back and eliminate sin and all the things that come with sin on this earth? Would you get rid of all that? Lord, would you come back and would you reign here on earth? That's what the prayer is. And see, what we learn in this is God is a God of justice, he's a God of holiness, and he's a God of truth. We know that. We know that God keeps his promises to his children. One of the great promises that we hold on to every day is that the Lord is going to come back. The good guys are going to win at the end. The people that follow Jesus are going to win. Okay? Jesus is going to come back and he's going to eliminate evil. Now, what we have to remember is this, folks. It's the Lord that does that and not us. What we do until that time, we actually do the things that Jesus has said. Things like pray for your enemies. Serve your enemies as well. And seek to lead them to Jesus Christ. That's what we do now. But there's going to come a day when the Lord is going to come back and he's going to judge their enemies. You know, Romans 12:19 says this, friends, do not avenge yourselves. Instead, leave room for God's wrath, because it is written, vengeance belongs to me, I will repay, says the Lord. So vengeance isn't on our docket. Vengeance is on God's docket. We do the things of the Lord. We go out there and we love our enemies. When these martyrs are crying out how long, they aren't crying out with some sort of a personal vendetta that God needs to get this done for them. No, they're crying out in earnest for all the things that God has promised us in the Scriptures. And I would challenge all of us folks in our prayers to pray, come, Lord Jesus, quickly come. And until that time comes, help me to be faithful in getting this word out to others. Verse 11. So they were each given a white robe, and they were told to rest a little while longer until the number would be completed of their fellow servants and their brothers and sisters who were going to be killed just as they had been. So there's a couple gifts. Well, there's one gift and there's one word that are given out here to these martyrs. Number one, they're given a white robe. This is a reward of grace. I wouldn't interpret this, folks, that when we go to heaven, we're all going to be wearing white robes forever and ever. But if we are, we're going to look good. Okay? But they're given a white robe, God's gift of eternal righteousness, blessedness, unity, and honor. The robe symbolizes the glory of the redeemed saints. There'll be glory of the redeemed saints in heaven. I don't care what we're wearing, okay? I don't even think I'm going to care if we're naked. That's scary, isn't it? But remember, that was the way it was in the garden. We'll see, and we'll see together. Then
they were given a spoken word blessing, and that word was simply rest. Rest. What was the word given? You're going to rest in this a little while longer. This was an invitation for them to stop their cry of vengeance and to continue to enjoy this heavenly time until God's wrath arrives. They were resting in the grace and the peace of Christ from all their struggle. They were resting from their exhausting labor on earth. They were resting from the wickedness of the earth. They were resting from the trials and temptations of earth. They were freed from all fears and sorrow and crying and pain and death. They are resting in the perfection of a new life, even in the righteousness for Jesus Christ. It was rest. As the concert closed last night with what was my favorite song, No Night There, No More Night, that David Phelps sang, just a beautiful song on what heaven's going to be like. Rest. So, folks, what I want to leave you with this morning is this. We need to pray for the persecuted church. We need to prepare to be the persecuted church, but we need to now pray for the persecuted church in other lands. And so take this outline home with you this week, and please pray for the persecuted church. I've got four things to pray for there. Pray that they feel the comfort and encouragement of the Lord. You have some scripture there to read with that. There are Christians today that are under great persecution. Pray their persecutors will come to know Christ. We've had people up here from countries. Just a few months ago, somebody up here that was ministering in a country in the Middle East. Okay? Great persecution for Christians, and they are over there sharing the good news of Jesus Christ, and they reported people are coming to know Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. Because that's what God does. God takes people, and He completely transforms them. Pray for that. Pray that in the midst of persecution, the church will be strengthened and continue to grow. Whatever the church looks like, churches in most countries, they don't look like this, okay? They don't look like gathering places like this. They may be little pockets, meeting in people's homes, sometimes meeting outside. But wherever, however it looks, they may become strengthened, and may they continue to grow, because, of course, there's strength in that. And pray that these believers will have access to God's Word. Folks, they love the Bible. Somebody called Brian this week, and they said, We're trying to send a bunch of Bibles to a nation that really needs Bibles. Do you have any Bibles for our church? I said, yeah, I got Bibles all over the church. They sit in the pews, they got dust on them. Take as many as you want. Okay? We've got plenty of Bibles. There are people yearning for this. And they read English. So we're going to give them a bunch of Bibles. Praise the Lord. Would you stand for closing prayer? Father in heaven, this is a lot. This is a lot for us to digest in this short period of time. There's huge challenges that are here for us. Lord, probably most of us in this church don't know anybody who's been martyred for you. We can read about it in Scripture. We could read this passage today and know that there are literally thousands in heaven right now who have been martyred for you. And we can't help but pause and think, am I willing to give my life for Christ? Am I willing to speak up if the heat goes up on me? And Lord, I pray that there would be great self-examination for us as a church in that. And that as persecution rises, that perhaps in this place, because we're so committed to your word, that our love won't grow cold, but that we'll love each other more and more deeply, committed to following in the footsteps of our Savior. And Lord, this morning we pray for those churches in so many of those persecuted countries. And we pray, Lord, that they would know strength. We pray for pastors who are preaching the word, who are seeking to preach the word with boldness, that you would give them strength, that you would give them comfort, that they would experience your peace in ways that we can't even imagine. And Lord, how we all look forward to the day when we'll be in heaven together and we will be amongst giants who in the midst of great hardship continue to move forward with the gospel. Oh Lord, continue to raise people up in this church to do that as we pass the promise from one generation to another. We love you. We give ourselves to you in Christ's name. Amen.